Schutztruppe was the official name of the German colonial armed forces of the protectorate itself, Germany Cephalica, German Southwest Cephalica, and German Cameroon. When the German Reich became a colonial power in 1884-1885, no provision was made for the creation of a national military formation in the German colonies. Chancellor Otto von Bismarck's idea was to have all instruments of power established and financed solely by the training companies active in these territories. But the companies either refused to do so, such as in Togo or Cameroon, or invested so little into their troops that these represented no serious power factor. In 1889, native resistance in East and Southwest Africa forced Bismarck's hand to finally agree to the creation of a local and colonial troop force, the Schutztruppe, or the Weizmann-Truppe. Though financed by the state, these troops were still organized under private law, but officially, the administration of both colonies still rested with the trading companies. All German members of the armed forces had to resign and sign contracts for employment directly with the commanders of Hermann Weizmann and Kurt von Hansel. After the so-called Aber Ostland, or the Abyssinian revolt, had been quelled and the German Reich had subsequently taken over the administration of East Africa, the Weizmann troops had been the first formation to be transformed into the Kaiserliche Schutztruppe, or the Imperial Protection Force, on the 22nd of May, 1891. The original plans did not include the transformation of the police force in Togo, established in 1885, or those of Southwest Africa and Cameroon, established in 1891. Increasingly frequent violent conflicts with the native tribes of the Hirohiro, the Abashuri, and even the Matabele, however, revealed the deficiencies of the existing instruments of power. Therefore, on the 3rd or 4th of May 1894, the Chancellor issued orders to reorganize all police forces in Southwest Africa and Cameroon after the model of the German East African Schutztruppe. The change of the name was official by the announcement of Kaiser Wilhelm, German Emperor, on the 9th of June 1895. In 1894, the police force in Togo was also reorganized with the intention of transforming into the Schutztruppe at a later date. But the planned transformation was delayed again and again and again, and finally abandoned in 1900, and that's how Togoland fell first in World War I. The Schutztruppe formed a third military branch alongside the army and the navy. It was an institution of the Reich, therefore, like the navy, subordinate only to the supreme command of the Emperor Kaiser Wilhelm II. On the organizational and disciplinary level, the Schutztruppe were at first attached to the Reichsmarine, or the German Imperial Naval Office, and on the administrative level, to the Colonial Department of Foreign Office, obviously. Conflicts over responsibility led to the transfer of the administration of all matters concerning the Schutztruppe to the Colonial Department in 1896, and then to the Reichskolonialamt, or the Colonial Office of the Reich, in 1907, while the Emperor ceded some of his authority to the Chancellor to crush rebellions or wage war in East Africa and Southwest Africa. They were authorized to deploy the Schutztruppe when they saw fit, for military purposes, civilian purposes, and for the purposes of civil administration, though only with the consultation of the respective commanders. The commanders of the Schutztruppe had the sole authority over all military matters such as training, discipline, and even equipment. This created a consultation unusual in the German Reich, where the officer reported to the civil servant. Modeled on the Weizmann-Truppe, the Schutztruppe of Cameroon and German East Africa were composed of German officers and non-commissioned officers, or NCOs, as well as African soldiers known as Askaris. Because German Southwest Africa was the only German settler colony in Africa, the lower ranks of the Schutztruppe then consisted of German soldiers as well. All applicants of colonial service were volunteers who had to fulfill formal criteria such as being fit for the tropics and fit in general, and free of debt, to be accepted into the Schutztruppe. The term of service was 2 years in Cameroon, 2.5 in East Africa, and 3.5 in Southwest Africa, but it was their biggest colony, so 3.5 is not too bad. Service in the colonies was convented because of the higher pay, the chance to take part in combat, and thus being promoted sooner and being decorated with an Iron Cross or a medal. During the 1890s, the African members of the Schutztruppe were primarily recruited in the colonies of other European powers because of rebellions and whatnot. Later, the majority of them came from the colonies themselves because of World War I and whatnot. Most soldiers were called askaris, especially in German East Africa. Volunteered to join the colonial armed forces and enlisted for a specific period of time, usually between 2 to 5 years. The considerable higher and potential and possible earnings than that of their occupiers, such as in British East Africa and the Belgian Congos, and their inherent social prestige attract many African men into the profession of the Schutztruppe. The soldiers had to subject themselves to rigorous discipline and training, however, and unlike the common soldier of the German Reich, Africans could be punished with beatings for the slightest offence, but this was not specific to the Schutztruppe. The racial hierarchy and corporal punishment that the African personnel under German command experienced were also common in other colonial armies in Africa. For instance, the British King's African Rifles, or the KAR, or the Belgian Force Publique, sometimes even more gruesome than just a beating. According to the Schutztruppe Gazette, or the Schutztruppe Act, the Schutztruppers were supposed to guarantee public order and safety in the overseas territories, that is, to serve more or less as a police force and to fight the slave trade, non-existent in Cameroon and Southwest Africa. In reality though, the Schutztruppers' main task in their early years was to extend the German territory, at first mostly limited to the coast where all the settlers live, but by force. The length of stage of conquest varied in all three colonies. In German East Africa, it lasted from 1891 to 1902. In German Southwest Africa, 1894 to 1903 and slight hiccup in 1904, and in Cameroon, 1894 to 1908, just on the eve of World War I, well, a couple of years back. In order to achieve these objectives, the Schutztruppe had to wage a number of wars, the Hill of Heroes, the Rebellions, and other such. The East African Colonial Armed Forces alone undertook 8 major subjugation campaigns between 1891 and 1902. With the conquest phase over, 2 major acts of resistance led to the biggest crisis in Germany's brief colonial history. In January 1904, the First Hero and Namas Wars rebelled. When the conquest phase was over, 2 major acts of resistance led to the biggest crisis in Germany's brief colonial history. In January 1904, first the Hero Heroes and then the Namas rebelled against the German colonial rule in German Southwest Africa. In 1905, around 20 tribes in East Africa followed suit. Both the Hilahila-Nama War and the Maji-Maji War ended only after massive reinforcements of the Schutztruppe arrived in Africa and years of heavy fighting and guerrilla campaigns. In response to these rebellions, extensive reinforcements and reforms were introduced, among them relieving the Schutztruppe of all administrative duty in 1906. In addition, the execution of minor retributive operations was delegated to the police forces existing in all colonies, while the Schutztruppe were to focus on enhancing their military capabilities. This included, in addition to an intensification of military training, the establishment of 2 permanent carrier corps in East Africa and Cameroon, and the creation of a single unit in East Africa. The permanent state of war in the colonies forced the Reichstag in Berlin, which had to approve the Schutztruppe's budget on an annual basis, to regularly increase it. From the total of 736 Germans and 1,914 Africans serving in the 3 colonies and armed forces in 1895, the number grew to 2,432 Germans and 4,122 Africans in 1914. In addition, in times of crisis, the Schutztruppe could expect massive short-term reinforcements. During the Hilahila-Nama War, for example, at times more than 15,000 German soldiers fought in Southwest Africa. As a rule, the Schutztruppers waged their wars against the native tribes with the utmost brutality and in contempt of international laws of armed conflict. The Schutztruppers generally made no distinction between the combatants and non-combatants, which meant that even women and children frequently became victims of hostilities. Since the African tribes tended to avoid open battle, the Schutztruppers usually employed a scorched earth tactic or strategy. The idea was to force the opponents to surrender by the systematic destruction of their natural resources. During the Hero Hero War in 1904, the Schutztruppe temporarily even practiced a type of genocidal war which killed between 65,000 and 80,000 people. Despite their superior weaponry, equipment, and even numbers, which included, in addition to, modern breech-loading rifles, machine guns, artillery, self-loading pistols, and even the Gewehr 98, the Schutztruppe were frequently forced to accept defeat. On the 17th of August 1891, the colonial armed forces suffered their biggest disaster in their colonial history, when an expeditionary corps commanded by Emil Zawelski and consisting of three companies ran into a Hehe ambush near Hagul in German East Africa and almost was completely annihilated. 10 German officers and non-commissioned officers, including Zawelski and 291 askari and 96 carriers, died. Though national defense was not explicitly listed among the duties of the Schutztruppe, the German colonies, in case of war against other European colonial powers, were not to be given up without a fight. Corresponding instructions for the event of war had been issued a few years before World War I, stipulating that the Schutztruppe, reinforced by Africans and German reservists, were to retreat fighting into the interior and maintain their position there, if possible, until the end of the war, which was not expected to last more than 3 months. It was hoped that it would improve the chances of regaining their colonies, if possible, in the peace negotiations, if Germany loses. But Germany never loses, except for World Wars, at least. All three branches of the German Schutztruppe fought longer than expected. In German Southwest Africa, for example, the Schutztruppe only surrendered to the South African troops, which outnumbered them on the 15th of July 1915, a full year. Some border skirmishes whose outcomes had been favourable to the Germans and a revolt as part of the Boer population or the Matimeritz Rebellion in South Africa had delayed the attack on the colony by several months. In Cameroon too, the colonial armed forces managed by means of sporadic counterattacks to delay the advances of the Belgians, the British and even the French units who attacked came from all sides but were too often uncoordinated. The Germans profited from the difficult terrain in the country, which was a greater obstacle to the attackers than the defenders. When the main force of the Schutztruppe faced encirclement, however, they crossed the border into neighbouring neutral Spanish Guinea and let themselves be interned there in late February 1916. So two years, not too bad. The biggest and most extravagant of all campaigns was in German East Africa. In German East Africa, the commander of the local Schutztruppe was Paul von Nettelrodewijk, and he refused to follow exact and existing orders. He favoured open warfare and had the neighbouring Belgian and British colonies attacked immediately after the outbreak of war. His intention was to force the Allies to transfer as many soldiers as possible from Europe to Africa to protect their overseas territories, their Achilles heels, in order to relieve the German troops on the Western Front. This plan kind of failed, however, since the Allies mainly deployed their soldiers from the colonial territories as well in the Eastern Africa and from South Africa. By repelling the British attempt to land at the port of Tanga in early November 1914, the Schutztruppe were able to delay the invasion of German East Africa by almost a year and a half. In March 1916, the Allies started a new major offensive and finally managed to conquer the whole colony in November 1917. But still, Lettelrodewijk refused to surrender and continued to fight the neighbouring Portuguese and British colonies and, of course, guerrilla warfare. Only when he learned of the end of the war, on the 13th of November 1918, did Lettelrodewijk give up the fight. After the German defeat of World War I and the insane loss of its colonies, Germany had no more need for colonial armed forces, and on the 10th of November 1919, the Schutztruppe of Southwest Africa, East Africa, Togo and Cameroon were officially disbanded. And on the 31st of March 1920, the Schutztruppe of Cameroon were dissolved. Anyway guys, thanks for watching, long-winded one, but that was pretty fun. That was pretty good, honestly that was pretty good. I didn't even expect to get this far, but it was hell of good. Now it's time to edit it. Oh my god, 1 hour and 30 minutes of just voiceover. But at least when I go, at least I do a whole paragraph in one take, so it's not going to be bad to edit, it's just going to be a slog to sit through, but I enjoyed it, so it's worth it. Anyway guys, that's it, the Schutztruppe, mostly black and white soldiers, colonial armed forces of World War I. It's a mostly black affair, because I mean, it's pretty much colonial forces, so you can't really rely on too much white people in the colonies. So yeah, I don't know, Minority Report for sure, Minority Special Forces maybe, we'll see. Anyway guys, this is going to be coming out Friday, or a day I'm not off, because this is too long. I already got the Ulan, so I got a video for today, so it's not too bad. Anyway, learn something, Granny should be home in about 5 minutes, so let me be the one to get out of here. And yeah, we're going to do weapons soon, we're going to do those weapons, and we're going to get that ball rolling. Anyway, learn something.